You just don't know.
We were also the first to put Bert Bolin of Sweden on international television talking about the dangers of carbon dioxide.
Trees grow more quickly.
And I remember being bitterly criticized by top experts for indulging him in his fantasy.
Climate hunters.
At the height of the cooling scare in the 70s, Bert Bolin's eccentric theory of man-made global warming seemed absurd. Two things happened to change that. First, temperatures started to rise. And second, the miners went on strike. To Margaret Thatcher, energy was a political problem. In the early 70s, the oil crisis had plunged the world into recession, and the miners had brought down Ted Heath's conservative government. Mrs. Thatcher was determined the same would not happen to her. She set out to break their power.
What we have seen in this country is the emergence of an organized revolutionary minority who are prepared to exploit industrial disputes, but whose real aim is the breakdown of law and order and the destruction of democratic parliamentary government.
The politicization of the subject started with Margaret Thatcher.
She was very concerned always, I remember when I was Secretary of State for Energy, to promote nuclear power. Long before the issue of climate change came up, because she was concerned about energy security, and she didn't trust the Middle East, and she didn't trust the National Union of Mine Workers. So she didn't trust oil, and she didn't trust coal. So therefore she felt we really had to push ahead with nuclear power. And then when the climate change, global warming thing came up, she felt, well, this is great. This is another argument, because it doesn't have any carbon dioxide emissions. This is another argument why you should go for nuclear. And that is what she was really largely saying. It's been misrepresented since then.
And so she said to the scientists, she went to the Royal Society and she said, there's money on the table for you to prove this stuff. So, of course, they went away and did that.
Inevitably, the moment politicians put their weight behind something and attach their name to it in some ways, of course, money will flow. That's the way it goes. And inevitably, research, development, institutions started to bubble up, if I can put it that way, which were going to be researching climate, but with a particular emphasis on the relationship between carbon dioxide and temperature.
At the request of Mrs. Thatcher, the UK Met Office set up a climate modelling unit which provided the basis for a new international committee called the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC.
They came out with the first big report which predicted climatic disaster as a result of global warming. I remember going to the scientific press conference and being amazed by two things. First, the simplicity and eloquence of the message and the vigour with which it was delivered. And secondly, the total disregard of all climate science up till that time, including, incidentally, the role of the sun, which had been the subject of a major meeting at the Royal Society just a few months earlier.
But the new emphasis on man-made carbon dioxide as a possible environmental problem didn't just appeal to Mrs. Thatcher.
It was certainly something very favourable to the environmental idea, what I call the medieval environmentalism of let's get back to the way things were in medieval times and get rid of all these dreadful cars and machines. They loved it because carbon dioxide was for them an emblem of industrialization.
Well, carbon dioxide clearly is an industrial gas, and tried and sort of tied in with economic growth, with transportation in cars, with what we call civilization. And there are forces in the environmental movement that are simply against economic growth. They think that's bad.
It could be used to legitimize a whole suite of myths that already existed. Anti-car, anti-growth, anti-development, and above all, anti that great Satan, the US.
Patrick Moore is considered one of the foremost environmentalists of his generation. He is co-founder of Greenpeace.
The shift to climate being a major focal point came about for two very distinct reasons. The first reason was because by the mid-80s, a majority of people now agreed with all of the reasonable things we in the environmental movement were saying they should do. Now, when a majority of people agree with you, it's pretty hard to remain confrontational with them. And so the only way to remain anti-establishment was to adopt ever more extreme positions. When I left Greenpeace, it was in the midst of them adopting a campaign to ban chlorine worldwide. Like I said, you guys, this is one of the elements in the periodic table, you know. I mean, I'm not sure if that's in our jurisdiction to be banning a whole element.
Destroying the wall, we're soon down.
The other reason that environmental extremism emerged was because world communism failed, the wall came down, and a lot of peaceniks and political activists moved into the environmental movement, bringing their neo-Marxism with them, and learned to use green language in a very clever way to cloak agendas that actually have more to do with anti-capitalism and anti-globalization than they do anything with ecology or science.
The left have been slightly disoriented by the manifest failure of socialism and indeed even more so of communism as it was tried out. And therefore, they still remain as anti-capitalist as they were, but they have to find a new guise for their anti-capitalism.
And it was a kind of amazing alliance from Margaret Thatcher on the right through to very left-wing anti-capitalist environmentalists that created this kind of momentum behind a loony idea.
By the early 1990s, man-made global warming was no longer a slightly eccentric theory about climate. It was a full-blown political campaign. It was attracting media attention, and as a result, more government funding.
Prior to Bush the Elder, I think the level of funding for climate and climate-related sciences was somewhere around the order of $170 million a year, which was reasonable for the size of the field. It jumped to $2 billion a year, more than a factor of 10. And that changed a lot. I mean,
that's a lot of jobs.
A lot of jobs, it brought a lot of new people into it who otherwise were not interested. So you developed whole cadres of people whose only interest in the field was that there was global warming.
If I wanted to do research on, shall we say, the squirrels of Sussex, what I would do, and this is any time from 1990 onwards, I would write my grant application saying I want to investigate the nut-gathering behavior of squirrels with special reference to the effects of global warming. And that way I get my money. If I forget to mention global warming, I might not get the money.
There's really no question in my mind that the large amounts of money that have been fed into this particular rather small area of science have distorted the overall scientific effort.
We're all competing for funds, and if your field is the focus of concern, you have that much less work rationalizing why your field should be funded.
By the 1990s, tens of billions of dollars of government funding in the US, UK and elsewhere were being diverted into research relating to global warming. A large portion of those funds went into building computer models to forecast what the climate will be in the future. But how accurate are those models? Dr.